Links us in the heart. The very first question that I thought of when I was asked to come and speak and address you as a welcome address on this day, I said, we have Children's Day, we have Youth Day, you know, UN has been organizing all these days, there's Peace Day, right? And then we have Women's Day, but we have no Men's Day. Right? Did we ever think why? It's interesting. We come from a culture which has held women sacred and which has also told women over the years that she was not enough. Just the very fact to celebrate this day specifically says volumes about how we as women have come across from centuries and stand today at a point. It's like a tipping point, it's like an edge. You know, we stand on the shoulders of our mothers, of our grandmothers. If you think of what their lives were like, what were they, and what we have become as women, I'm sure it will make for interesting stories to tell around a fireside, around evenings. Things that we will tell our daughters. I'm glad to see that there are men in this room. I would have said that for a Women's Day celebration, it would have been very interesting to have more men than women. Who needs to hear about women? I don't know. I think it's more the men. I'd love to have a dialogue with the men on this day and say, what is it that you think of us as women? How do you see us in this modern time when there is not even a question of equality even arising? I bet all of you who work, people like you who are in a cancer institute, somebody like you who's working for anti-aging, right? Somebody like Josh who's lived half his life in the US. I don't think it's a question of equality anymore. It's a question of finding our roles and being able to do the best that we can as human beings. See, this is not a question of women. I think it's a question of the feminine energy, right? It is something that all of us come from. The first person in our lives were our mothers. And often she's the one who stays practically all our life as our backbones. And that never changes. Somewhere the grandmother also has a very powerful role to play. The thing that shaped us, right, we hold it so dear, and yet when you go out and work, that very value that makes a woman is contested and often seen as a lesser value, and that is why we come together for a Women's Day. Do we value in our cultures things like kindness, affection, empathy? Is that seen as weakness? Right, that men can rule and control the world, but women have a very different attitude when they come into those roles. There is an innate sense of cooperation. I mean, which mother, how many of you are mothers here? Can you raise your hands? All right, interesting, me too. How many of us would like to see our children squabble? We don't like to see our children fight amongst themselves. All right, because we love them all. Which mother can love one child more than the other? I bet you it's not possible. Every woman can stand witness to the fact that it is she who holds the family together with that simple thing called affection. Isn't it? So, when you go to a workplace and you bring that same value to the corporate world and it is seen as something called weakness, what kind of a world have we built ourselves in? Women are healers. Women heal the heart, that deep intuition. Today's theme is intuition, right? We are going to talk about intuition. What is intuition? Where does it come from? What role does it have to play in today's world beyond just women? Because I can tell you, I've been lucky enough to know many men in my life who have these feminine qualities of love, gentleness. I am associated with this organization now since many years. I was practically born into it with the practice of meditation, which I started pretty early at the age of 14. I realized that I know so many men who could make lovely mothers, who are so soft, who are so gentle in their hearts. Years of meditation practice has brought out that feminine quality and that balance in them, isn't it? So we all have that. We know that. It's part of us being human. Then why should it stay just the force of women? It comes naturally to us. But this Women's Day, shall we look at intuition? Shall we look at harmonizing the principles of Purusha and Prakriti, right? The two polar opposites due to which creation happens in the world. I would say, and I'm convinced now more and more, that it is the feminine principle that came first in creation. She is the space, she is the darkness from which everything came. She's acceptance, she's tolerance. She's the one that received the dynamic male principle to give creation its place. And we have that in our DNA. It's part of each woman. She doesn't need to be taught that. So how come we have created as humans a world where that is not valued? And how can we change that? How can we bring it about together, playing powerful roles? Because each one of us now work, almost all of us work outside, and those who don't work are the backbones of their families. They educate their children. It's very powerful when you're a mother. You create the psyche of your children from day one. It's the mother who influences the child till the age of 7 or 8 more than the father. What kind of a world are we going to leave behind if we don't wake up today and take back our capacity to be loving? To bring that intuitive capacity back in human existence where it should belong, to take it to governments, to take it to the world, to create a place where no woman would have to say me too. No man would have to listen to her say me too. This is something that we can share, we can establish. And what kind of a role does a simple thing like meditation play in it? So while we explore all that, I invite you to write down your questions, to think, and to take part in this beyond Women's Day. See, it's not just one birthday that we are celebrating. It's the creation of humanity that we celebrate when we come together for Women's Day. Because believe me, it is the foundation. We all feel it in our hearts. We want to tell our truth out to the world, isn't it? As a young girl, you wanted to say it. As a woman, you're able to say it. As a mother, you'll be able to establish it. Right? The three parts of the woman, the maiden, the mother, and the wise woman who comes later. What is the legacy that you will leave? What is the legacy you got from your mothers and your grandmothers? And how are you going to change that for your children? Let's think about that. Let's work upon it. And I invite you today with our wonderful guests and speakers. I'm really wanting to listen to them, so I'm going to stop here because I just really want to hear what they have to say about this. And I hope that even after this gets over, we will continue our exchanges, whether on Facebook, Instagram, or just over the phone. And for once, like they say, women gossip a lot. Let's gossip about the right things, right? And have fun while we're doing that. So I welcome you all today to this, and I hope you have a lovely time here. Share with us, and I welcome you to keep coming back to us as often as you want in this lovely place, not only to meditate, but to share. So welcome everyone.
The theme for today's discussion is intuition. And I'm reminded of a Facebook quote which goes like this. G.K. Chesterton very famously said, "A woman validates her intuition through her intelligence." You know, I repeat, a woman validates her intuition through her intelligence. With that quote, I invite Ms. Vijayalakshmi Srinivasan, who's the director of Athena Health, and she is one lady whom I can very boldly say has validated her intuition with her intelligence and risen to the post of director of Athena Health. Welcome, Vijayalakshmi.
Welcome, one and all. Good evening. Thank you, Sister Purnima. Nevertheless, it's definitely just not a statement. I'm a strong believer of intuition, and I wholeheartedly believe that, you know, it is intuition that has certainly and definitely guided me and my life path throughout this journey, and I would like to share some of the experiences with you here today. So happy Women's Day to one and all present here, and you know. So I truly feel honored and privileged to have this opportunity to be here today and share a few thoughts with you. I'm hoping to begin this day with a quote from Steve Jobs. So I'm sure we all know Steve Jobs, the co-founder of Apple. So his quote on intuition is certainly interesting. "Have the courage to follow your heart and intuition. They somehow already know what you have to become. Everything else is secondary." So let me repeat, Steve Jobs mentioned, "Have the courage to follow your heart and intuition. They somehow already know what you have to become. Everything else is secondary." So I truly believe in everyday's life, in this fast-paced life, we certainly see a lot of extraordinary signs and messages that pops up within us day to day. We may be doctors, engineers, corporate executives, parent, spouse, or employees. When you really tone down and take a minute to recognize and listen to your inner voice, to your intuition, it can actually warn you. It sends you a lot of message when you are in danger, uncover an ingenious idea, help you understand people and situation better. I'm sure all of us must have certainly experienced this all through our life. So how to keep an eye on this intuitive experience in everyday's life? And what can they teach us? The value of intuition in decision making is often apparent in our day-to-day life. I'm sure we as working women often end up having to hire lots of employees. How many of us have actually interviewed a couple of people who are almost the same in their experience, in their expertise, but having decided to choose one instead of another? And if you did that, why did you do that? Think about a situation where you felt like stepping out of your home and decided that something is not feeling all right, and probably pushed to a different time frame and not wanting to pursue it. How many of you felt like not doing something but ended up doing it and felt lucky, and vice versa? If you think about it, how do you relate and resonate all of these things in your life? What made you decide what you decided in all through? What was the logic? What was the reason behind what you did, why you did? So I'm sure learning to tap into your inner wisdom can save you from making a wrong business decision, picking wrong business partners, a mismatched job. It saves lots of money and time, which you could have wasted otherwise. So let's now try to define intuition. I hope we're all in agreement that intuition is about knowing something without actually knowing it. You may not know why you feel the way you feel. It's because it naturally comes from that part of the brain which you actually don't control. It is basically the conscious, which is beyond your control and which is actually a reflection of your inner voice, and you may call it a hunch or a gut feeling or perhaps intuition. So let's see what researchers have to say about intuition. Intuition is our brain's ability to draw on internal and external cue in the moment. So let me repeat, it's actually in the moment. And it's an important skill, particularly in high stress situation. When people make decision based on their intuition, it's often difficult to explain why they made the decision, but they just know it and they feel that it's the right decision to have been made. So I'm sure all of us would have experienced it. Sometimes you don't know. I mean, when folks ask you, why did you do it? You just say, you don't know, and you felt it. And I think that's to do with intuition. So let me explain to you, how intuition has its origin right through the BCs. We all know the famous Julius Caesar, right? So Julius Caesar's wife in 44 BC, she basically requested Julius Caesar not to go to the Senate because she didn't feel something was not right. So he did not pay a heed to his wife, and you all know he was ended up being stabbed, and he was dead with last few words, and you know, with his last few famous words. Let's come forward and look into one of the recent histories in 1800s. Our 19th U.S. President was invited to basically join dinner with Abraham Lincoln. Where his wife Julia felt that he shouldn't be going, and he paid heed. And later he realized that day Abraham Lincoln was shot dead. While at that moment it could have been difficult for these two wives to have explained why they prevented their husbands from basically going out, perhaps it's their intuition. I'm referring this because I know all of us as women in our everyday life often passion. So a recent MRI scan which was done on women has basically proven that typically men brain are neurologically wired to be more logical, while women on the other hand has more neural connection, which makes her more empathetic and intuitive in nature. So set aside the MRI scans of researchers, let's see what scientists have to add about intuition. So a group of scientists basically at the University of Granada proved that female intuition might actually be biological. So, and it has to do with testosterone. Men's testosterone made them logical, while female estrogen makes them very emotional, and that is perhaps the basis of intuition. So let me also talk about the Ayurvedic discovery. They basically call a mother's womb as a second heart, and this mother's womb or the second heart is directly connected to the creative energy or the source, which makes a woman more intuitive than men. So learning to trust our inner voice is very important, so that we learn to integrate our intuition with logical reasoning. So it's a, let's not forget that it's a nature's gift from above, and it's the basic and fundamental truth that women are intuitive. So let me talk about how do we develop this intuition in us. Please pay attention to the very first feeling or thoughts that comes to you when you think of a moment or a situation. Notice when your feeling was right. Stop being embarrassed about your feelings. Your feeling is the guidance all through your way. Connect with your soul and develop your right brain through meditation. So, intuition is like a muscle. The more you use it, the more it gets stronger. So it's very common to ask, how do I know whether it's my intuition or my imagination? I'm sure we all of us are confused, right? What's an intuition versus when am I actually imagining? And how do I prove that it's my intuition and rather not my imagination? Well, good question, but here's your answer. Think about it. Whether it is coming from you or is the thought coming to you? Think about it. What's your answer and how do you feel? And secondly, to find the difference between intuition and imagination, ignore the guidance once and see if it repeats. Usually the unwanted things drop off, but that which is natural stay on and it keeps guiding you. Sometimes you have tuned yourself to overwhelm yourself with the logic that unfortunately it basically eventually has to drop off and die. So ladies, my request to you is please ponder over intuition, which is a very unique gift from nature to us women from above. One can actually have a very fulfilled existence only when a body, mind and soul can actually work together. When can a body, in a group of doctors, I take the privilege to say when the body can actually work well, when we sleep, diet, environment and we exercise. When the mind is functioning as it is intent to function, it's fully self-aware, focused and quiet as required. The soul is driven by wisdom, love and universal service. The only way to experience a very holistic state of body, mind and soul is to basically practice meditation. And this is exactly what we do in our heartfulness meditation practice. So, Buddha was once asked, what did he actually gain in meditation? And he said, nothing. And he added, but let me tell you what I lost practicing meditation. Anger, depression, insecurity, fear of old age and death. I'm sure all of us in this stressful society are gripped with all of these feelings. Fear, anxiety are all the time behind us. Well, when we cross our 50s, we naturally start thinking about the fear of life and death, right? So, heartfulness meditation offers a chance to experience the benefit of meditation. It equips us with tools and techniques that can help us achieve this state by consistent practice. Learning to meditate not only develops our intuitive state, but also helps us to lead our life in a much more balanced and blissful state of existence. So our entire body is led by feelings and inspiration. And that is the role of heart. The heart is also the seat of love, intuition, and feeling. And when we manage to listen to the heart over and over again, we basically bring the best which is hidden from within us. And I think we can master our life by racing to listen to our heart again and again. And this whole exercise of fine-tuning our heart to live in a very balanced manner is the process of heartfulness meditation. Rooted in the system of Raja Yoga, this heart-based meditation uses yogic transmission, that is divine energy from Mother Nature. This form of meditation gives many people the opportunity to master their lives by listening to their hearts. Heartfulness is a super inclusive form of meditation that has been around for hundreds of years and has benefited thousands of souls around. It is an experience which anybody above 15 years of age can have, and it is actually free of cost. It is incredible and unbelievable that a woman plays various role, and that too with full of love and enthusiasm. Woman is a mother, a sister, a wife, a daughter, and the most dedicated employee at her workplace. She is indeed the pillar of the society on whose shoulder there is this onus of taking this country forward. The next generation, I think we have lot of reasons to make the best foundation for the next generation. I think of late we have lots of WhatsApp forward on why we shouldn't be eating burgers, why we should basically follow everything that is natural. I wish to say that, and we are basically thinking about where we have gone, and you know, we are basically reverting back to where we have started, perhaps our grandparents and much before, right? We are looking back at the tradition and we are discovering it as if we are discovering for the first time. Meditation is absolutely not at all new. It has ever existed. If the stories of Buddhas and Jains have inspired us, and if they have got enlightened sitting under the tree, heartfulness meditation basically brings that form of meditation in a capsule which can be followed without having to necessarily run to a forest or sit under the tree for hours and years long. It can absolutely practiced in the course of your everyday life, spending a little amount of time thinking, sparing those moments. I'm sure you will never regret. Perhaps it can help you develop, or rather become even more intuitive and give reasons back to the society on the lost or forgotten tradition of meditation. I welcome you all once again, and for gracing this great occasion. It's colorful to basically see all of the ladies, and there is so much of joy. My hope is that we have a taste of this heartfulness practice today that we can carry in our heart for us and for our generations in future. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Vijayalakshmi. So women are basically people of the heart. That's what I feel, of intuition, of heart, of creativity. So in the midst of all this, there is this wonderful book called The Heartfulness Way, and we are so lucky to have Joshua Pollack with us today, who is the co-author of this book, The Heartfulness Way, along with Kamlesh D. Patel, affectionately called Daji, who is the Global Guide of Heartfulness Institute. Joshua Pollack is a trained Western classical violinist, and I think, since we are from Chennai, we can associate him more with having performed alongside A.R. Rahman in movies like Gajini, Delhi 6, Ravan, and so on. He's a very versatile person. He's a heartfulness trainer and practitioner since a lot of decades. And thank you for coming here today. I invite you to share a few words of wisdom and introduce the book Heartfulness Way.
Happy Women's Day, everybody. I didn't think I would. Last night, I was at home in New Delhi, and I thought, there's no way I'm gonna make it here today. Because for the last 2 days, I'd had some bacterial infection of the stomach, and I'd been in the hospital, and my wife says, talking about being grateful to women, I am grateful to my wife, Ariel, for forcing me to go to the hospital at 2 o'clock in the morning so that I could get an IV drip and everything like that. And sitting in one of these uncomfortable plastic chairs next to my bed for the full night as I lay there on the cot. And then proceeding to go to work at the US Embassy for a full day, the next day, actually. And then flying directly to Chennai for something else. So there is a kind of force to her affection and nurturing, which I think is something which is absolutely necessary for somebody like me. We're here to talk about intuition, talking about heartfulness. I think that intuition is something which we have a lot of ideas about. We often confuse it with or associate it with telepathy or things like that. I consider it as a sort of sense. But like any sense, I think it is important to know where to focus our attention. Suppose you're intuitive, fine. But what do you see, or what do you perceive or feel with that intuition? Are you able to perceive the noblest things with that intuition? Or are you only picking up on other people's disappointments and depressions and things like that, negative things? So I think heartfulness is not about simply developing intuition, but I think it's about learning how to perceive the very highest with a very sensitized intuitive faculty. And that intuitive faculty needs to be very sensitive, because the highest thing, the divine thing, is always the subtlest thing, which means that it's not the easiest thing to perceive. In order to perceive that, imagine just how refined your sensitivity will have to be. How refined your intuitive sense must become. So this is to rise above all of the turbulent emotions that we experience on a day-to-day basis. The intuitive faculty must become sensitized and refined. This means that we have to refine our hearts, because intuition is ultimately about the heart. Because it's something that comes in the realm of feeling. It comes in the realm of feeling, not in the realm of reason, not in the realm of intellect. It is not as if we are understanding things through inference. This is direct perception. Direct perception. And in order to do that, in order to feel, then we need, of course, to look at our own hearts. But our hearts are also the places where we experience so much turmoil. In fact, all of our turmoil also comes from the heart, in the form of so much emotion. So just because we go into the heart does not automatically mean that we are going to develop a refined sense of intuition. We can also go deeper into our own problems by focusing on the heart. So the question becomes, what are we doing with our hearts? And that is where it becomes very helpful to have a method. Instead of just sitting there and saying, okay, let me try to feel things. To have a method to turn that sense of perception upwards, as this famous quote, which I can only paraphrase because I can't quite remember it, but let my eyes only see beautiful things, let my ears only hear noble words. This sort of idea. So how to achieve that? In this system, we meditate along with something called yogic transmission, a mysterious concept, but only until you experience it, because experiencing anything demystifies that thing which you don't know about. If you want to eat a mango, you've never had one before, your friend tells you what they taste like, Still, you won't understand what it's all about. You have to taste it, then you'll know for yourself. So experience always is the only thing which can demystify anything. So yogic transmission, as we understand it, as we're speaking about it here, we can compare it to this nice breeze which we're feeling. See, most of the time, we're not aware of the air that surrounds us. We know it's there, but we're not paying attention to it. We don't sense it on a moment-to-moment basis. Of course, when there's a breeze, then we become aware of it. Similarly, our parents and other people throughout our lives are telling us about the presence of this noble thing, this higher thing, which we want to intuit, which we want to perceive. They tell us about, they may use words like God, right? They may tell us about something divine or godly, some godly force or presence. And just like the air that surrounds us, we also don't notice it. So then we either have to believe it or disbelieve it. We may discount it altogether, and we're within our rights to discount it because we haven't experienced it. Why should we believe it? But I would say that when we're speaking about yogic transmission, all I can say is that it is the breeze. Okay? It is if God is all around us and we never experience that presence, then yogic transmission is a process by which that essence becomes somehow animated. Becomes so somehow animated, and like the breeze, now you're able to feel it for the very first time. And because of this, now you see something higher. You experience something more noble. Your intuition now is working and looking at something higher than it's ever seen before or perceived before, subtler than it's ever felt before. This happens, meditating along with yogic transmission occurs when we meditate along with a trainer. In our tradition, we meditate along with a heartfulness trainer. And that trainer has been prepared to be able to trigger that flow. And as a result of that, then we're able to feel something. And that's also why we meditate on the heart, because the heart is the place where we feel things. No other place. You don't meditate on the ears. If you're trying to listen to somebody speak, you don't listen to them with your eyes. So why would you try to feel the divine presence with the tip of your nose? It's with the heart that we feel things. So we meditate on the heart. And meditating on the heart, along with yogic transmission, we're now able to feel something beyond what we've ever been able to experience before. Now this is something that has to be experienced in order to be understood. It is not something to be believed. Rather than being believed, it should be discounted unless and until you decide, okay, let me see what this is about. And have your own experience, form your own conclusion. And this opens up new dimensions. This opens up a whole new life, I would say. A whole new experience of life. So this is the basis of heartfulness meditation. And this is the subject of the book, The Heartfulness Way, which goes into great detail how to meditate, what meditation is all about, what yoga transmission is, how we move away from the influence of heavier emotion and move without moving away from the heart, still remaining within the heart, how we move away from the influence of emotion and go into more refined feelings. Because there are proven techniques that can help us achieve all of these things. Of course, each of these techniques, the fact that they are proven means nothing because they have to be proven over and over again for each individual. Everyone has to prove heartfulness for themselves, ultimately. It is not something, spirituality itself is not a field where you can rely upon anybody else's achievement. Every day we rely on the achievements of others. I don't think any of us could build a GPS system. Maybe a few of us. I don't know who's in this crowd. Maybe a few of us. But most of us couldn't build a GPS system. But we can use them. And we don't need to know how to build them either. It's enough that we put them in our vehicles and they can get us where we're trying to go. But spirituality is not like that. Spirituality, you have to do everything for yourself. You have to experience everything for yourself. You have to learn everything for yourself. And that learning is something which doesn't come from books. It doesn't even come so much from experience and learning lessons, but it comes absolutely through intuition, through your own heart. Your intuition becomes like a new language that you're learning, where if you've ever gone to a new place, a new state, or a new country where you don't know the language, and before you go, you study up a few words. And then when you get there, you hear someone using a word that you've learned, and you say, aha, I recognize this word. Right? But you don't yet have the confidence to be able to respond. In a similar way, intuition grows. It's like learning a new language. All of a sudden, something will occur to you. You'll feel that this is the case. Yes, I know how this is. But you've only ever been accustomed to trusting your intellect, to trusting your knowledge and learning. So what do you do with this new sense? Do you go along with it? Or do you rely on what you've been accustomed to doing your whole life? So we have to have a little bit of courage to go into this path. We always have to have the courage to trust these inspirations and intuitions that are coming seemingly as if from within. But it becomes easier because the more you trust them, the more you find that they lead you only in the right direction. But we have to become very pure along the way. Because what happens when you receive some knowledge from somewhere? Are you going to misuse that knowledge? So I don't think it's possible at a certain point to move further into intuition unless our motives become absolutely pure as well. We absolutely won't receive the intimations about the truth of a particular situation unless we become selfless to a certain extent. Otherwise, it becomes like, where you're a computer hacker or something like that. You're learning things that you shouldn't know. So everything about this is about becoming pure and going higher, becoming subtler. And that's what the heartfulness way is. So I invite you all to have your own experience. If you feel like it, you can read the book. But the most important thing is to follow your own heart and to do what it says, not to try heartfulness just because we're here talking it up and saying how wonderful it is, but if you feel as if your heart is calling out for something and you want to go further in your life and you want to go a little higher in your life and see whether there's something more to life than what you've already been experiencing, then that's a good reason to try heartfulness. So thank you very much.
Good evening, all of you. A very happy Women's Day. I don't know why I'm standing here, really. I just, when they call me as a chief guest, I again and again ask Nandita, like, I'm a woman who goes around and keeps telling people, do this, do that, self-examine your breast, watch for symptoms, this and that. Do I really fit in? She said, anything you want, you come and speak anything you want as a chief guest. That actually made my task more difficult. This is something, heartfulness, the term itself, I was hearing for the first time. I was thinking again and again, I have heard hearty congratulations, but not heartfulness. I've heard wakefulness, thoughtfulness, everything. So it was totally intriguing for me. And actually, in fact, I was discussing about that when I was on my way to this place. So she beautifully explained why it is called heartfulness. Then it struck me, in Tamil also we call Idaya Kamalam. So everything starts from the heart. Something like Idaya Kamalam, or that's lotus feet. That is related to the heart. But still, heartfulness is the word that gives me lots of possibilities. Heartfulness is something it made me think. And I also was thinking, she told me, you can bring in some spiritual thoughts related to your work. I don't know really how I'm going to fit in. Should I come and teach self-rest examination for the people? Is that going to be a women's group? Because I'm totally into a different thing. But then I started thinking about that, and as I entered, I met a gentleman, and I was just telling him, I've been to this place a couple of times. I just walked around, but not here. And he said, you are coming here with a purpose, some universal conspiracy, I don't know. But what I realize is just being here in itself is being an experience for me. The well-ventilated place, so poised, the well-mannered conversation between people. So it was really itself being an experience for me. So I was just thinking over what would I come and speak here. Just yesterday evening it struck me, okay, it being a Women's Day, why should I speak about the women who are being a true inspiration in my life? So everybody, as all of the prior speakers were telling, a mother is your inspiration, she is there throughout her life. I thought I will touch upon the inspirers in my professional life who mold me as a person also, to make me evolve, to really help me evolve into a person also. So in the next brief, so I told Nandita also I want a PowerPoint presentation because this is what I'm going to do. And here we have this PowerPoint presentation just to show the woman who I think who shaped me day to day. So as I said, I was thinking of all this, and today I experience what heartfulness is. Thanks for that. So this is the Cancer Institute in 1954, just a two-room cottage, and now it is a multi-storied building, a facility of a world-class tertiary care center. And next. And hope all of you know about these two women. I may not talk about them, but the women on that side, that is, the right side is Dr. Muthulakshmi Reddy. She is the first woman doctor in South India. She was the first woman member of the Legislative Assembly, and she was the one who founded this Cancer Institute 63 years ago. And Dr. Shanta, on this side, all of you must be knowing her, who is a living inspiration for me. every day, day in and day out, like 93 years, she's 92, she has completed 92 or 93 on March 11th, and she's going around with a couple of events like this on the Women's Day. So still, she's a living inspiration for me. So why I talk about her? Next slide. So I think no other person in the whole world, like in the world of oncology. So what, like cancer is something, the field, the discipline is something which has rapidly evolved, and every one of us is like, I mean, coming across in our day-to-day lives. But the various aspects of it, from the perception of the disease, then its acceptance, then what was the outcome 50 years back, what was the scientific contribution to the disease, the diagnosis, the treatment, the evolution. So it has gone a long way, though it is a rapid, but she is the only person, I think, which many scientists also agree, who has lived along the evolution of the whole disease in its path. So she herself describes, like, yeah, it is from a case of incurability where there was no hope, now to curability, to control, and palliative care, where we try to support the patients to fade away with dignity, and now to the era of personalized medicine, where lots of molecular investigations and research are going on to make it more personal. So she is the one person who is living through all this. So she knows how it was then and there, as considering the whole discipline and also the Cancer Institute. Next. So she describes her journey as, these are her own slides. I just borrowed these two slides from her for this. So this, her journey all the 63 years in the Cancer Institute was that of one from agony to ecstasy. And I'm the one who joined her when it was almost ecstatic. And so maybe that was one of the reasons I'm also standing here today. Next. So who are these group of women? These are the women who prove that there is life after cancer. These are survivors who have survived some form of cancer and still come back to the Cancer Institute and contribute as volunteers in many ways. They are being the moral support to the newly diagnosed cancer patient. I salute them on this occasion. So they forget, they put behind their past, they beautifully came out of the whole agony, and now they are giving back in a more beautiful way. I salute them for that. Next. So now I'm a part of a preventive oncology department, and maybe Dr. Kaushalya is going to talk about the lifestyle. And so preventive oncology is something like, it's a multi-pronged approach, and that's what we are taking to the masses, to women, about screening and everything. So from there, next. What we are trying to do is to make this healthcare, to make this this preventive care an equitable healthcare, which is, I think, the need of the hour. And as Martin Luther King says, the inequality in healthcare is the most inhuman of all inequalities. So that is how, through preventive oncology, maybe from the guidance of Dr. Shanta, we are trying to do that. So I have some beautiful, inspiring women in that part whom I'm just going to talk about. Next. So this is how we have outreach programs. We go out into the community. These are our staff. Next. So these, I want to talk about these girls, the nurses. So what we are trying to do is, we have outreach centers in many places. Now we are starting in other districts also, out of Chennai also. So when we try to start some cervical cancer and breast cancer screening program in other places, like say in Tirunelveli, when we started in 2012 with the help of an NGO, the greatest challenge was to get a proper evaluation of their pap smears. You know, pap smear is a cervical, it is a smear, it is a cells taken from the cervix, that is the mouth of the uterus, and examined to see if there is any precancerous changes so that we can prevent cancer. Cervical cancer is a preventable cancer. So this is a simple test which can tell us that if there are any precancerous changes. And unfortunately, now even now we get women, it's still the number one cancer, being a preventable cancer, this is the number one cancer in rural areas, and women come in advanced stages. Nearly 50% women come in advanced stages. So that is where we try to do something. And when we try to get some cytologists, cytotechnologists, actually it added more problems, like it was not working at all. So then we thought, like, whoever is available, why we not train and utilize them? And then came this test called a HPV testing, that is a human papilloma virus testing, the virus that causes cervical cancer that can be detected, a more objective test, and that can tell us like whether she is going to get cervical cancer with some further test, and whether we can train these 10th past girls to do that. And it was a very experimental, and we just gave an attempt. These are 10th past, not even nurses, nursing assistant, because that is the workforce available next in the rural areas. So when the person, Dr. Paul from US, who is on this extreme left, he came to quality check what is really happening, whether we are actually doing, because we are doing something in a low resource setting should be really useful. We should not be more problems, adding more problems to what is already existing. And when he came, he was so impressed by their focus, he brought all the PhD technicians to that center and trained for 1 week with these girls just for their focus. How they focus, how they give the test results. And still they are doing, and for the past 3 years, they have analyzed more than 15,000 samples very successfully, and we have prevented nearly 118 cervical cancer in Viripuram Taluk. So when we started this, when this actually conceptualized, it was very experimental, and I thought whether it is going to work or not. But then this was a very good learning. So even when women in the marginalized sections of the society get an opportunity and they are guided well, that brings the best potential. That brings out the potential out of them. Next. I also wanted to include this slide. I wanted to talk about this woman. She is Shadigans, a social worker, a PhD, and also an artist who is part of a World Artist Forum. And she is also a breast cancer survivor. She is a German, and she has moved to India on work. Maybe her husband is working here in a corporate, and she has been living here for quite a few years now, and she has observed that breast cancer is an emerging problem, and even though it is not as bad as the incidence is as bad as the Western counterparts, but women dying of breast cancer is more compared to there. And as a single woman, she put all her efforts. It was a struggle, because I was also part of that. I was going through, I was aware of what she's going through all these 2-3 years in a place where she doesn't understand the culture, where she doesn't know anyone, where she doesn't understand the language. She's based in Bangalore. She has heard about Cancer Institute, and she wanted to reach out the rural women through Cancer Institute. And for 3 years, she focused, she was so determined, she had so many odds working against her, but then finally she succeeded in bringing out that bus with a Mama Mobile installed in the bus, and now that is successfully running in Viripuram, and we are offering mammogram to rural women free of cost. So that was possible because of just a thought and efforts of one single woman, and that her efforts were very persistent and determined. I learned a lot from her. Next. Last but not the least, every day I meet these women. They are the women who struggle in and out each day. They have so many, we can't even imagine. Like, I called them for a colposcopy today, this Wednesday. They may be living in a village close to Pondicherry, it may be under Viripuram. But then she has to come take the previous day's bus, sleep in Coimbatore platform, and then she has to report to me morning at 10 o'clock. They don't even think of breakfast or water. I mean, we can't even imagine like what they undergo. The strength, I don't know. I mean, where do they get the strength? But they don't know how to take care of themselves. We have to teach them, but they somehow know how to take care of others. That is one thing I always learn from them. I learn a lot from their strengths, from their vulnerabilities. And they're such loving people, they immediately make me their daughter, their sister. And that is the most fantastic, a very satisfying experience, which makes me love my work and go back to my work each day. Look, I just look forward to working for them just because of their, just a very pure love. They know to give that. So I salute them, and without them, I mean, I'm not made and I'm not what I am today here. Thank you for this opportunity, and thank you for listening to me. I don't know how relevant to all this, but I thought like I will share this with you all. Thank you.
This was a very heartwarming talk by her. Of course, she shared a lot about cancer. It was a lot of technical things. There were a lot of interesting anecdotes and stories, and we saw the journey also. But more than that, you know, what I think really touched my heart was how simple she is, what great inner strength she has, how much love she exudes in just a simple technical conversation. You know, I'm like floored. I have no words. I don't know what to say. I mean, thank you so much. It's just a word when I say thank you, but please know that it's from my heart. It gives me a great honor to introduce yet another eminent person, Dr. Kaushalya Nathan. So one of my friends, Nandita, she was traveling with Rani. Rani was traveling with Kaushalya, and she said, oh, I'm so totally bowled over by her. I don't know, all of us women, you know, we are bowled over by each other, and today I want us all to take one moment and be bowled over by ourselves. So let me get on with introducing Dr. Kaushalya. She's an eminent celebrity, lifestyle and anti-aging consultant. She has a broad base of regional, national and international clientele. The very often neglected homemakers approach her to deal with her with their stress and lifestyle disorder, which are often not understood. Dr. Kaushalya Nathan is a regular and prominent person in various educational institutes, important event addressings. School children, youth and adults, and also on the importance of healthy lifestyle. She's a pioneer and celebrity in her own right. She's also been running a show on Sun TV for the last 10 years. I'm sure we are yet to begin another journey in bowled over, in being floored over. Welcome, ma'am, please.
Greetings, Women's Day greetings to all, and I thank Mrs. Janani and the team for giving me this wonderful opportunity to be here. And I congratulate the author and co-author, Mr. Joshua Palak, who's here, for launching of this book, The Heartful Way. And I'm one of the probably the early privileged, person to receive the book. And I've gone through the book as well. It was such a journey for me to understand about that why meditate and how we meditate and when to meditate. It is extensively, beautifully written, like a story where I didn't even know that, you know, I could complete the book in 2-3 days' time. Usually, I keep such readings for my travel, but it was a wonderful journey for me, and I think, I'm sure most of you here would have, you know, read that book, or if not, I think you should. See, and the chief guest gave us a wonderful inspirational talk, and today I would like to focus on two things. Now, this meditation, I think being in this, all of you have learned the art of meditation. I'm sure all of you have been meditating and know what meditation is. Today I'm going to share just few of my thoughts on the scientific aspect of meditation. Because when you do things, now these days the question arises on why and how. It's more for us to understand, to have a better clarity and to know more about it so that we continuously do what we actually do,
And second thing is, you pass it on to the next generation. I was actually talking to Mrs. Rani while coming here about how important it is, because we have so many whys. Your kids will ask, why should I meditate? You know, what is the benefit? You are just kind of, there's nothing in meditation. You know, yoga is nothing. It has nothing to do, you know. There's so much of why and wants. Now, going back, now I like to start, you know, WHO, World Health Organization, has very clearly defined health as a state of physical. We all know about it. When we have a problem, we all go to a doctor. So that bit, all of us are aware of, and we somewhere are psyched about the physical health part, yeah? Second is the mental health. Mental health is also catching up in a big way, and there is an kind of an, you know, trend which is developing, and thanks to the media and a lot of, you know, stuff where, you know, educational materials are available to understand the mental health. And there is an emotional aspect of emotional health, and a spiritual well-being is what even WHO talks about, well-being in the definition of health. But unfortunately, coiling back into the healthcare industry, which is actually a disease care, I'm sure Dr. Mallika will agree with me, and I'm so happy to meet her here today because she's working on the preventive aspect, which I think is a missing aspect, which I've always kind of dreamt and wanted to be the past 20 years, and it was a struggle for me, but I'm very happy that I took the path and I'm still in that same line of preventive healthcare. So now the healthcare was always focused on only disease care, but it was named as healthcare. Under healthcare, focus was on disease care. If you fall sick, you go to a doctor. Otherwise, nobody likes to go to a doctor. Nobody wants to go to an hospital. Do you really feel good going to a hospital? No. Do you feel good waiting outside an hospital, you know, meeting your doctor? Definitely no. So there's always a fear factor which is surrounded in a very strong way, which I think is a negativity which medical system unfortunately has brought into this physical health, or I would say health per se, which has been understood in a very wrong way or to a very limited extent. Now going back to this well-being part, which is part of WHO's definition, is what is the whole message of, you know, what researches are available, whether it is evidence-based, if meditation has any kind of evidences, do we have any publication to talk about it, or it is just a hearsay that, you know, some guru was talking about meditation, he passed it on the method to you and you pass it on to the next generation, because the next generation is not willing to take that pass on guru shishya concept. They want science. They like to know why I should meditate, what is happening in my body when I meditate, what are the changes, is it happening, or is it just like saying, like, you know, a grandmother story of grandma's way, like, you know, saying put oil on your head. I said, why should I apply oil on my scalp? You know, there is a why to everything. So today I would like to share a few of my thoughts, because I've been honored and I've been probably working in this field of yoga and meditation and research. And my mentor, Dr. Naveen Vishwesharaya, has published nearly over 200 publications in the field of meditation and its positive effect on mind and body. He did an interesting paper on tuberculosis. Tuberculosis is believed to be an infectious disease, right? So we all know there is a bacteria which is causing tuberculosis. Finished. That's where the health, the disease care industry stops and puts you on a long-term meditation. He was the first person, and he also kind of proved it, published it in a peer-reviewed international journal, how breathing exercises facilitate faster recovery in tuberculosis patients with a positive sputum. You know, that degree of an effect the spiritual medicine has got, and it's time to talk about it. Not many doctors talk about it because of lack of time, and probably their focus and specialization is different. But I've been talking about this spiritual aspect of health way since I've known, and way since I've been in the media, and every little opportunity. And when they were mentioning about, you know, a heartful way, I thought I'm very happy to be here to share evidence-based meditation is available. Now, the evidence says that meditation, especially with even infectious diseases and non-infectious diseases, has an impact at the molecular level, at the cellular level. Now we are talking about molecular medicine. Way back when we started the generation or the medicine, way back, this was a part of it. But we never proved it. Now we want proof for everything. You know, do I have proof? Do I have, I feel tired. Do I have a proof that I have hypothyroidism? Do I have a proof that I have, you know, I'm depressed? Do I have, so we want proof for everything. So now in the last probably 15 to 20 years, there's enough research publication available, and there is an Institute of Integrative Medicine in Harvard Medical School, and also in many leading institutions abroad, and there is also catching up in a big way in India as well. So the actual benefits of meditation, which has been evaluated and published, are at the molecular level, it improves your immunity, your cellular immunity. Your immune system is strong. If you meditate, you will not be getting cold and cough and fever and infectious diseases faster than the other group, which probably are non-meditators. So that's the first thing that we should know, and that has an impact at the molecular level. The second thing is about inflammation. Inflammation is a very early aspect of even cancer. I'm sure Dr. Mallika will agree with me. So the inflammatory stage or the inflammatory markers, which are all published, are all very high level of TNF-alpha to interleukins. These are all inflammation, you know. That also can be reversed with regular meditation. And if somebody is on chemotherapy or somebody is on any acute kind of an therapeutic or an advanced stage, still meditation brings in a very positive and a scientific molecular aspect of benefits. The third is reduces the cortisol level, which is a stress level in our body. We are all stressed, let's admit it. There is nobody who is stress-free, and if there is no stress, we can't have a normal life. Stress is needed to be normal. Only thing when it goes overboard is where we have problems. So the stress aspect, the cortisol, can be brought down with regular meditation. And most important thing, because me coming from the field of lifestyle and anti-aging, there is actually an end of the chromosome. There is something called telomere. And I'm not trying to be technical here. I'm just telling you that there is an enzyme which actually acts on prolonging the telomerase activity. That part of it which lengthens your lifespan, you know, is done, and it facilitates while you're meditating. So if you want to live long, meditate. If you want to live well, we meditate. So meditation brings in a lot of positivity, just not mind, body, even at the molecular level, even at the genetic level. So meditation plays a very important aspect in our day-to-day well-being, which has been evidence-based, it's been published, and now people are kind of trying to put it together. But we're all very kind of fortunate that, you know, you've already been meditating. I'm sure some of you have been experiencing the positive benefits of meditation. Well, you heard science so far. Now let's move on. I don't want to talk about science now. You know why? This science bit is only for probably publications. It's probably to tell your kids that it works. But this is an experience. Unfortunately, when we question why, we miss out on experiencing. If at all we all sitting here have to question how much percentage of oxygen is there in this air, are we all getting enough oxygen here, are we breathing well, is my lung well, would you breathe or you will stop breathing? We will stop breathing. So don't question so much of it, because it's of finer things happening. I'm just telling you that it happens because somewhere you all believe, and let there be a confidence in you that meditation works at the molecular level and the evidence is available. But don't question the method of meditation, or don't question the practice of meditation, because it's an experience. If at all there is a Mysore Pak given to each one of you, you know, what would you call it? You would just probably say it's sweet. But nobody has asked so far, can you prove the sweetness in Mysore Pak? I can't. Nobody can ever prove the sweetness in Mysore Pak. It's an experience. I can prove Mysore Pak has sugar in it. But I can't explain, or I can't publish a paper, or I can't prove the sweetness that Mysore Pak brings into our system. So what I'm trying to tell you is, when we have to experience stuff, 99% of the finer things, the most beautiful stuff which does good to you, are only experience, and it is unfortunately not science. Though there may be enough publication, because that's the reason science is evolving. We have found new things. Still we are going on. The rate at which the pharmaceutical industry has grown, we all should be disease-free almost. You know, we must be healthy. No, but it's again mushrooming. More problems, because we have missed out on this important era of well-being, which actually is missed out in the healthcare industry. So what I'm trying to tell you is, it's important for us to understand the benefits of what we do, and it's beautiful experience that each one of us should feel and experience without questioning it. When we stop questioning, that is the time your intuition blooms. Can you prove an intuition? No. You can never prove an intuition. You know, you can prove a thought maybe with some functional magnetic resonance imaging and big, big stuff. We can spend a lot of money and bring out a paper. But intuition cannot be proved. You know, with this quote, I will conclude about the intuition, which improves with meditation, is prayer is you talking to the God. Intuition is God talking to you. So that is the difference. You know, where once we meditate, when you look inward, that's the time you hear. If I'm always talking, I can't hear. If your mind is always jumbling something, you can't hear what your intuitions are. So we need to slow down, calm down, and then go inward. Settle down a bit, then your life will be full of intuitions. And I've experienced it myself. I've been a meditator. Probably I'm blessed. Since the time of 16, my own medical curriculum put me into that path of yoga and meditation. So that way I owe it to my parents. And what I'm going to kind of conclude here, saying that when we need to experience the beautiful stuff, don't question. But if the next generation is questioning you, please attend to it and answer, because we need to bring in the blend till they understand and get the maturity of what we all experience. We need to still keep feeding them science. So that's where the science is important. But don't kind of, you know, question the whole factor of the meditation and the benefits to a larger extent. Instead, just kind of go inward and meditate. You know, that is one of the reasons where none of the gurus gave you a scientific evidence or any practice or went into any lab to prove meditation. We have no Buddha didn't go and, you know, prove or publish any paper, because it's beyond. They knew it. But then somewhere down the line, we also wanted it. But now we have both ends meeting. Now it's time to meditate. So thank you very much and have a wonderful evening.
Thank you so much, Joshua, for your very wonderful introduction of the book, The Heartfulness Way. Today's chief guest, Dr. J.S. Mallika, is an MD, a gynecologist. She's trained in preventive oncology and gynecological oncology from Tata Memorial Hospital, Mumbai. At present, she is the head in charge officer of the Department of Preventive Oncology at the Cancer Institute. Her main focus is to spread cancer awareness among masses. She's responsible for organizing cancer awareness program for women welfare groups and free cancer screening programs for the less privileged in the society. I now call upon her for giving us a short talk. Amongst us, there are a lot of women, honorary women achievers, and it's time we honor them, we felicitate them. I would like to request Joshua to hand over the Heartfulness Way books to all the important women achievers today who are with us. Joshua, please. Yeah. From Anna University, Dr. Devaki, a general medical practitioner, Mrs. Maithili Sundaresan, homemaker, Mrs. Pushpita Pujari, an educator and content developer of science programs, Mrs. Swarnalekha Sethuraman, founder and managing partner of Trinity, Mrs. Rama Venugopal, executive director, Mrs. Nikita S. Prema, a Reiki healer, Mrs. Lakshmi Ramakrishnan, anchor and director, Mrs. Tara Umesh, a professional casting director in the modeling agency, Dr. Mini Rao, psychologist, champion in football, Mrs. Komala Shivakumar, Mrs. Jayalakshmi Ramesh Kumar, accountant of L&T Finance Limited Ashram, Dr. Ratna Devi, consultant radiation oncologist in the Apollo and architect, Mrs. Soumya Ganesh, a social worker, Montessori educationist, Dr. Preet Agarwal, Associate Professor, Sri Ramchandra Hospital in Porur, Chartered Accountant, Company Secretary and Behavior Analyst. Mrs. Jayalata Prakash, Quality Manager, HCL Technologist. Mrs. Smithy, Customer Coordinator in various online portals. Mrs. Veena Krish, Director of Pedrino Food and Beverages. Dr. Srimati Kesan, Founder, CEO of Space Kids India. Dr. S. Yamuna, Pediatrician of Finance in Rajasthan Gas Production. Dr. Lata Maheshwari, Sand Artist. Dr. Sai Priya, Bharatanatyam Dancer. Ranjini Kumaravel, Consultant, Marketing and Communications. Speaking about it is not giving us a lot of meaning and significance. So now let's have a small session of heartfulness, relaxation and meditation. And I'm sure you will have a lot of takeaways after that. So let me give you a run through in a very crisp way. We will have a brief session of heartfulness, relaxation. And you will be given mental suggestions to relax your body. Following which, there will be a short session of meditation. Please close your eyes during the relaxation session. During the meditation session, you will be requested to meditate by focusing on the source of light in your heart. I request you all to switch off your mobile phones or put them in aeroplane mode.
Let's begin with our toes. Wiggle your toes. As it is moving up, calf muscles and knees.
I believe each one will be having some experience. Unique to yourself. Go home and try it and see it. And we welcome you once again to the Heartfulness Center here, anytime, any day, when you're free. So, as we are almost nearing the conclusion of this event, I request Ekta Bodale to deliver the vote of thanks. And as soon as that's over, I request all of you to not disperse immediately. Let's have a group photo of all of us together to cherish and to look at it every time and remember this day with joy. Ekta, thank you.
It's difficult to talk after a moment like this. And coming back to our everyday consciousness, picking up the threads of life, going back to what we do best. I'm sure we shall carry with us these moments, especially the ones I believe that we lived in the last part. These very personal moments, these very beautiful moments where we connected with ourselves, which inspire. I'm sure you heard so much that was said today by so many wonderful people. We started with Vijayalakshmi, who gave us an amazing idea of what intuition is. Right? She explained to us what is the very framework of intuition. We had our chief guests, right, Dr. Malika and Dr. Kaushanathan, who gave us a wonderful idea of what is the science behind meditation. Like, that was so energetic and so beautiful, the way he told us how meditation is something we can talk to our young about. I was absolutely stunned by the way he said it. Dr. Mallikar's amazing experience with women in cancer research. We had Josh who told us how, and it's very difficult. I mean, when I listen to Josh, I find it's amazing how he puts into words things that are very difficult to explain otherwise. So why don't we have all these amazing people tell us and show us the hows, the whys? I'm sure somewhere, when we go back, we capture one or two things and keep them with us. Most of all, I do hope you keep this experience with you, where you met yourself, where you spend those few moments within yourself. And let me tell you, you can do this every day at home, on your way to work, times when you want to feel the need to connect with yourself, and you find the need for inspiration, for grounding your intuition. I would love that we connect more, and we should have the time. Thank you so much for taking this time and coming. Listening to four people talk so much is a feat by itself, and still stay awake and still listen and still have that smile on your face. I think we really need to thank you for that, for being here with us today. I'm sure you will enjoy reading this book. If you have anything you need to share with us about that, kindly come back and please, please, please do meet us again. We shall very much be pretty much here. We leave you with all our coordinates, etc. And as you go back home, feeling honored, feeling so special about being a woman, and thanking the universe for being this expression of creation, I welcome you to join us after this in a moment of shared light conversations. We have some informal conversations. We'll all be here for a while. Thank you so much for coming and seeing us today. And thank you for being here. Thank you for being lucky, wonderful women that you are. And a very happy woman today.
She's in fact set the tone for the for a future event in this program, in today's session. There are some things in life which cannot be explained or talked about. They have to be experienced. In fact, Helen Keller says the same thing in, you know, a different way. And let me say that this journey was even more mind-blowing. I mean, thank you so much, Dr. Kaushalya. I request Ms. Ekta, the Joint Secretary of the Heartfulness Institute, to hand over the bouquet to the chief guest. I request Joshua Pollack to hand over the Heartfulness Way book to our chief guest now.
ஃபஸ்ட் ஆஃப் ஆல் ஹாப்பி உமன்ஸ் டே விஷஸ் மேம். இப்போது வந்து இந்த ஜென்ரேஷனில் உமன்ஸ் டே நார்மலாக எல்லோரும் செலிப்ரேட் பண்ணிட்டுருக்காங்க. இப்போது வருங்கால ஜென்ரேஷனுக்கும் இந்த ஜென்ரேஷனுக்கும் உமன்ஸ்களுக்காக ஸ்பெஷலாக
அட்வைஸ் கொடுக்கறத விட நான் என்னோட தாட்ஸ் ஷேர் பண்ணிக்கலாம். அட்வைஸ் சொல்கிறதுக்கு எனக்கு ஐ டோன்ட் திங்க் ஐ ஹவ் த ரைட்ஸ், பட் ஐ கேன் ஆல்வேஸ் ஷேர் மை தாட்ஸ். நான் என்ன நினைக்கிறேன்னா, நிறைய மிஸ்ஸரிஸ் பார்க்கும்போது, நிறைய இப்போ ஹாசினி 7 வயசு ஹாசினி கொலை செய்யப்பட்டா, நிர்பயா, நந்தினி, அந்த மாதிரி வரிசையாக அப்போல்லாம் தோணும், கடவுள் எங்கே, ஏன் அந்த குழந்தைய காப்பாற்றலைன்னு தோணும். அப்போ அதுக்கான ஒரு ஆன்சர் நம்ம தேடுவோம். அப்போது என்னோட ஜஸ்டிஃபிகேஷன் என்னதுன்னா, கடவுள் வந்து மனுஷனை மட்டும்தான் அந்த புத்தியோடு படைத்தார். ஸோ அவரோட அம்சம் நம்ம ஒவ்வொருத்தர்ட்டையும் கொடுத்துட்டு நீங்கள் உங்களை பார்த்துங்க சொல்லிட்டாரு. ஸோ இண்டிவிஜுவலி அண்ட் கலெக்டிவ்லி ஆஸ் அ ஹியூமன் ரேஸ் வி ஹாவ் டு பி வி ஆர் ரெஸ்பான்சிபிள் ஃபார் ஆர் ஹாப்பினஸ் அண்ட் மிசரிஸ். ஸோ அதனால் மிகவும் அவசியம் ரெஸ்பான்சிபிளான தனி மனித ஒழுக்கம் இருக்கிற மனிதர்களை உருவாக்குறது, லீடர்ஸை ப்ரொடியூஸ் பண்ணுறது, ரோல் மாடல்ஸை கொடுக்கறது நம்ம கலெக்டிவாக நம்மளோட கடமை. ஸோ அதனால் அந்த அதுக்கு அதை நோக்கி தான் ஐ திங்க் எவ்ரி ஆஷ்ரம் ஓர் எவ்ரி சகஜமாக கூட அதை நோக்கி தான் யூனோ அந்த அந்த அவேர்னஸையும் அந்த எஜுகேஷனையும் அந்த ரியலைசேஷனையும் மனுஷனுக்கு கொடுக்கணும். அப்போ தான் நம்ம இந்த வி கேன் மேக் திஸ் அ பெட்டர் பிளேஸ் டு லிவ் இன் அண்ட் வி கேன் ரியலைஸ் தட் வி ஆர் காட். ஐ வுட் லைக் டு விஷ் ஆல் த மென் அவுட் தேர் ஹாப்பி விமென்ஸ் டே. தேங்க்யூ.